Well, I was 18 years old when I met William for the very first time. My brother and I worked on the facilities team at our church, and we were at an overnight shift about 1 a.m. on December 26th. The church was empty, just the two of us. We had finished our tasks for the night. We had walked our rounds, making sure everything was secure. There's nothing crazy going on. And we settled in our auditorium and decided it would be a great idea to watch a movie on the big LED screen. And this is when I met William Wallace from the movie Braveheart. If you have not met, or if you've not met William before, if you've not seen this movie, oh my goodness. It is all about a Scottish man who led the charge for Scotland's freedom as the oppressors, England, were keeping them under their reign. Not only did he stir the hearts of men and strike fear in the eyes of his enemies, but he wore this incredible kilt that I am incredibly jealous of that he could pull off, and I most certainly cannot. There's this one scene in the movie where they are preparing to fight the English army. And the English army is, they're out-weaponed and out-manned. The Scots have almost no chance of winning this. And the Scottish people are getting nervous. Like, should we run and flee? Should we just get away with our lives and not actually fight this? And then William Wallace steps up. And he says, "Run and you'll live. Fight and you may die. But if you run and you live for just a little while, one day, many years from now, lying in your bed, would you give every day from now until then for just one chance to tell your enemies that they may take our lives, but they will never take our freedom." And the crowd went wild. Guys, it sends shivers down my spine. That scene has stuck with me in that moment. I mean, come on. Like, how many times have I rehearsed that in the mirror? Just getting excited, wishing I was there with William himself. It makes me proud to be Scottish, and I'm not even from Scotland. William Wallace stirs the hearts of these men. He gives them something to sacrifice their lives for. He says, "Choose the battle that is worth your energy, your attention, your time, maybe even your death." And in doing this, he encourages them to value the best thing over a temporary solution of running away. Now, Paul, in this letter to Timothy, his second letter to Timothy, does something very similar to this. I don't think Paul had a Scottish accent, though it is possible. You never quite can tell. But Paul encourages Timothy and challenges Timothy and spurs on Timothy to greater works. Today, we're looking at this letter that Paul gave to Timothy. And for a little context, just so you guys are aware of where Paul is when this letter is being written, he is in prison at the moment this letter is written to Timothy. And Paul's own words, he is near death. Paul thinks he's in his last legs of life as he knows he's been persecuted for teaching the gospel and thinks that this may be the end of his days. And he writes this letter to Timothy, encouraging him and spurring him on to say, fight the good fight. He challenges Timothy to address some of the false teaching that's going on within their church and to step up in his own church leadership and his own following of Jesus. And there's a whole book or letter that we could take a look at, but I want to just zone in on three metaphors that Paul gives about the Christian life, what it looks like to follow Jesus well. It says this in 2 Timothy 2, 3 through 7. You can follow along on your outline. Paul says, "Endure suffering with me as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. Soldiers don't get tied up in the affairs of civilian life, for they cannot then please the officer who enlists them. And an athlete cannot win the prize unless they follow the rules. And a hardworking farmer should be the first to enjoy the fruits of their labor. Think about what I am saying, for the Lord will help you understand these." Pray with me. Jesus, as we dive in tonight to this piece of scripture, would you speak to us? Would you allow these truths to enter our minds and our hearts? Would you allow them to affect the way we live? Lord, we love you and we trust you and we pray these things in your name. Amen. Well, the first metaphor that Paul gives to us is pretty clear. He says, following Jesus is like being a good soldier. Now, there's a little box next to your outline. I'll leave this slide up for a second so you can write down that little outline or that little fill-in. But there's a box next to this fill-in for you to draw a picture of your best soldier. I brought this little sword so you guys could get a little visual up here. I also brought a couple sketches, one done by me and one done by Lexi Smith, one of our very own HSM students. Mine is definitely the worst one over on this side. That one's really incredible. So go ahead and sketch that out. Paul says, following Jesus is like being a good soldier. Verse 3, endure suffering along with me like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. Soldiers don't get tied up in the affairs of civilian life. Underline that part. Soldiers don't get tied up in the affairs of civilian life. For then they cannot please the officer who enlists them. In case you don't know, a civilian is just a non-soldier. This means soldiers don't get tied up in non-soldier things. They're focused. A soldier's job is to follow their commanding officer's orders. The commanding officer strategizes for the whole army in mind. The good of the whole nation is what they're sending orders out for. And they give orders to one of the soldiers. And those orders aren't just for the sake of forcing the soldier to do their bidding, but for the good of the whole group. I have a question for you. Have you ever been in a situation where someone asked you to do something and you forgot to do it? Anybody else been there before? Yeah, it's the worst feeling ever when they come back later and they're like, did you do this? And you're like, oh no, I forgot. Like when you are just knee deep in Fortnite Battle Royale and you're like about to get that victory and your mom asks, can you go do the laundry for me? And you're like, yeah, I'll do it later. And then you never do it. And that weekend you're like, oh, I can't go out with my friends because I didn't do the laundry. We've all been there before. It's the worst. Well, one would be a bad soldier if they were asked to do something and they forgot or chose not to do it. If they got distracted from the orders, a good soldier doesn't forget their assignment. A good soldier is focused. Amidst the distractions of life, they focus in on their orders. I've been reading a book recently where there's an army fighting against this malicious empire. And the only way that they are able to accomplish anything, the only way that they're able to win any of the battles is if the army men, the soldiers, follow the orders that they're given. The only way they're able to set up a camp. The only way they're able to besiege a new castle. The only way they're able to organize a strategic attack is if everyone plays their part and follows the order of the commanding officer. The same is true for those of us that follow Jesus. A good soldier in the army of Jesus, we're supposed to focus up on our orders, to zone in when life gets hard. We can't get distracted from the one thing that matters, the gospel of Jesus, to know him ourselves and then to allow others to get to know him as well. Now, this doesn't mean we have to dedicate every single moment of our day to reading our Bible and isolating ourselves from everyone else so we can just focus on Jesus, but rather it means that we have to make sure that Jesus is the priority in our lives. When we're on the sports field, is Jesus still the center of our focus? Are the words we're speaking after a play that doesn't go our way, are they still honoring Jesus? In our friend group, when someone else starts speaking poorly of someone else, are we participating in that conversation or is our heart and mind set on Jesus to only speak highly of other people? Are we prioritizing Jesus in all that we do? Because as our commanding officer, we have to put his plans above any of our own. So are you focused on the plan? Do you know what orders Jesus gives us in his word? Are you following them faithfully? The second metaphor that Paul gives us is that of an honorable athlete. Paul says, following Jesus is like being an honorable athlete. I brought a basketball because all good athletes play basketball, obviously. Here's a little doodle I did as well, in case you're curious about this. Yeah, incredible. Obviously, mine is this one, and this one is Lexi's. Fantastic job, Lexi. Following Jesus is like being an honorable athlete. Paul says this in verse 5. Athletes cannot win the prize unless they follow the rules. When I was a kid, my parents had to find a way to entertain me and my two brothers. And so in our Midwest basement, they decided to put up two mini basketball hoops for us to play. And we ate it up. We taped out a three-point line. We made free throw lines. The whole nine yards, we did everything. And we had two kinds of basketball that we would play. your everyday normal basketball, the kind that you'd watch on TV, and the other version, which we affectionately like to call Zooball. Now, Zooball was essentially basketball with no rules except one, no tickling, because obviously. You could put someone in a headlock, you could push them over, you could kick them. You had to do everything that you could to prevent the other person from scoring on your hoop. It was chaotic. And there was one time in particular that me and my younger brother were playing, and because I was a little older, I was a little bigger than him at the time, and was dominating him. I mean, I'm pretty proud of it. Like, I was doing real well. And he got fed up. And so he took that ball, lowered his head, and ran straight into me as hard as he could, sticking his forehead right into the bridge of my nose. I crumpled. I started crying. My nose hurt so bad. We went to the doctor. They were like, it's not broken, but it's as close as it can get to being broken, which feels like you should just tell the person that it's broken. I have this bump in my nose now, all because Brock slammed his forehead into my face. Like, it was chaos. It was chaos. Now compare Zooball to the 2024 USA men's basketball team. Anybody watch the Olympics this year? Yeah. Pretty incredible. They had one game right before the championship where they played Serbia. And entering the fourth quarter, they were down 17 points. And they played 10 minutes of some of the most beautiful basketball that you've ever seen. Like, team basketball, everyone played their role. No one got angry when the play didn't go their way and commit a foul. It was only described as an incredible achievement because they all played the game the way it was supposed to be played. The difference between these two types of basketball, like Zooball in my basement and the USA men's team, is drastic. It could not be more stark. Zooball, which disregarded all the rules, it was chaotic. It only ever led to hurt and tension in our relationships. But this gorgeous version of basketball where, like, you could not help but keep your eyes glued to the screen because it was just that enticing. This is what Paul is getting after when he's telling Timothy that we are made to be an honorable athlete, that following Jesus is like being an honorable athlete. Because when we play the game that it was intended to be, we get the prize as the result. And guys, our prize isn't a nice big gold trophy. Our prize is deep peace, no matter what circumstances we walk in. Our prize is joy in the most depressing, heartbreaking season. Our prize is love that overflows out of us because we know that we are so deeply loved by a God who cherishes us. Our prize is confidence. When people are speaking poorly behind our back, we know whose we are. We know where our identity lands. When we choose to follow Jesus like an athlete who follows the rules of a competition, we gain a prize that we all deeply want, a rich and satisfying life. A life full of peace, a purposeful life. Life as it was intended to be. So here's a question. How well do you know this book? If someone asks you, how do you live according to the rules of life, could you tell someone, this is how the Bible tells us to live. And this is the life and the joy and the prize that comes with it that I'm experiencing because I'm living according to the words. The third metaphor and the final metaphor that Paul gives us in this section is that of a farmer. He says that following Jesus is like being a hardworking farmer. I don't know anything about farming. This is actually not my rake. It's Jason's. Thank you, Jason. A big expert farmer over there. Following Jesus is like being a hardworking farmer. Feel free to draw me if you need inspiration. Otherwise, here's a little bit more on the screen. Yeah, again, Lexi, fantastic job. Me, C+. I don't know a lot about farming. But of the three metaphors that Paul gives, like, this is like the least glamorous to me. I'm like, okay, like an athlete, I can get behind that. An athlete who wins games or like a soldier entering into battle, like that sounds exciting and I want to be a part of that. But your everyday mundane farmer, like that's kind of a lame metaphor. And yet though it doesn't sparkle and shine as much as the other two metaphors, I do think that this one might be the most important of the three. I only know a little bit about farming, but what I do know is that it's not fun work. You wake up early, you go to bed late, You spend the whole day toiling and working hard in the fields. And the type of farming that Paul is talking about here, talking to Timothy about and using a metaphor for, they didn't have any fancy John Deere tractors. They didn't have any machinery. Like, this is sweaty, grueling work of being in the soil, weeding and pruning and harvesting and planting. Like, the work never stops. And yet, this is the metaphor Paul gives. Now imagine with me for a second that you grew up on a farm, that you're a farmer at heart, and yesterday you ate nothing, but today you have to wake up and do a whole day's work on an empty stomach. Doesn't that sound terrible? Like, I can barely make it from 9 a.m. breakfast to noon lunch without a nice hefty snack somewhere in between there, but a whole day of farming without any food yesterday or today, terrible. It would be no fun at all. This is exactly what Paul is trying to tell us. That if we are going to follow Jesus well, we have to be spiritually fed. We have to make sure that we are eating. We have to make sure that our hearts are getting what they need, that our souls are getting what they need by spending time with Jesus. We can't serve others or do the work of God if we aren't ourselves filling up first. We need to be reading his word, spending time with him each morning in prayer, asking him, God, would you give me what I need for today? And thanking him for who he is, knowing he is our one provider. He is the God who cares about us, who created the entire world. God, would you give me what I need today? Can I ask you a challenging question? If you're in the room tonight and you would consider yourself a Christian, are you spiritually feeding yourself? Are you waking up each day and getting the spiritual nutrition you need by spending time in this book? By praying? By being with Jesus? I don't ask this to shame anyone. That's not my heart at all. But if we're going to do the work that God has assigned us well, we need to make sure that we are first being spiritually fed. Paul gives us three fantastic metaphors, and each of them has unique aspects that I really deeply love. But one thing that they all three share in common is this, is that following Jesus requires perseverance. All three of these metaphors, if you're going to be a successful soldier, you have to have perseverance. You cannot give up when the battle gets hard. If you're going to be a successful athlete, at the first sign of sweat, you can't lose it. You've got to be in the game and persevere through any trial that the game has. If you're going to be a successful farmer, you better have perseverance, because there's going to be some drought seasons. There's going to be some moments where you don't know how you're going to get to the next day. Following Jesus requires deep perseverance. Last weekend, my friend, you guys might know him, Pastor Stephen Tadina over in JHM, ran a marathon. I know, yeah, we can get a little cheer for Stephen. 26.2 miles of running. Anybody here ran a marathon? Okay, oh, wow, incredible. You said it was terrible. Yeah, that's exactly what I thought. I was like, 26.2 miles. In case you don't know what that looks like, 26.2 miles looks like running from the San Clemente Pier all the way to the Newport Beach Pier. Yeah, I'm seeing some of the faces in the crowd like, that is crazy. Why would anyone do that? And yet, Stephen would tell you, there were some moments where he was ready to give up. After mile 20, he was like, man, I am this close to throwing in the towel. And yet he didn't. He chose perseverance. He chose to run the whole race, and he felt deep joy and excitement when he crossed the finish line in under 4 hours. Like, my man killed it. Killed it. And running a marathon, like, that's a worthy goal and achievement. But how much more so of running the race of life well? Of running the race with Jesus in a way that honors him and glorifies him and gets to know him, but also introduces him to other people. What a beautiful calling. There is no higher calling than a life lived with Jesus. As Paul kind of wraps up this letter to Timothy a little bit later in chapter 4, he says this, he refers back to those three metaphors, and he says this, "As for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. For the time of my death is near, and I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race, and I have remained faithful. And now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on the day of his return. And this prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to his appearing." Friends, this is my prayer for us, is that we can see Paul's encouragement to run the race well, to fight the good fight, to remain faithful. And we can choose that in our own lives. And one day, many years from now, when we're on our last legs, we can look back and say those same words. Say, "God, I have fought your good fight. I have ran the race that you've set out before me. I have been faithful to you." And friends, no greater joy will we experience than getting that promised prize. That rich and satisfying life that starts the moment you come to know Jesus and continues through all of eternity. By living in these ways, we get a rich and satisfying life, and we get to invite others into that as well. Would you pray with me? Jesus, right now we just come before you, just humbled that you would even invite us to be a soldier in your army, that you would invite us to be an athlete on your team, that you would invite us to be a farmer in your town. Lord, right now I ask for perseverance. I know that there are people in the room that need it, God, that are struggling on their journey of faith, that are walking a little bit further from you than they wish that they were. And right now, God, I ask that you would fill them with a fresh hope, with fresh perseverance to run the race that was laid out before them. To, like Stephen, not give up at mile 20, but run to mile 26.2, where they get to cross the finish line and celebrate with you. Lord, we love you and we lift you up. We pray all these things in your wonderful name.